Hi, it's Gary with SCP. Today I'm going to be taking you through the steps on how to replace the PCB system on this 2000 BMW 5 Series. This is the M52TU motor, but the process will be the same for the M54, which you'll find in most of the later Model 3 Series and 5 Series. So let's get started. Alright, so the first thing I'm going to do is remove the intake. This car has an aftermarket intake, but the process is somewhat similar. It's usually a couple bolts to hold it down. I'm going to release the hose clamp that holds the mass airflow sensor onto the upper intake boot. You're going to press down on this clip in the back here, which is going to release the mass airflow sensor wire. And then there's these clips on the side of the mass airflow sensor you have to release. They just kind of flip up. Remove the mass airflow sensor during this time. Right, the next thing we have to do is remove the fuel rail cover. There's two 10 millimeter bolts. I've already loosened these up, so just come right off. For extra room, I'm going to remove the driver's side passenger cabin filter box, which comes off pretty easy. Alright, we have to continue to remove the intake system. So there's a lower boot and an upper boot. Gotta remove this air line, which this is a vacuum line for the brake master cylinder. This could be kind of tricky to get out. See, it's ridged, it kind of just goes in there. So that's out of the way. Now you have a couple of hose clamps down here that you have to release some tension from. All right, if you're having issues removing these lower hose clamps, you can also go ahead and remove the DISA valve, which is up here on top of the motor on the side of the intake manifold. There's two Torx screws, they're T40s, and once again, a lot of the electrical connectors on BMWs, you press them, a little metal tab, comes right off. I'll just put that off to the side. And you have one Torx screw here, another one down under here. So to pull the DISA valve off, if you see like an oily substance over it, that's perfectly normal, so don't worry if you see that. And also be careful, these fins, they are very fragile, they can break, so put this off somewhere where you're not going to run over it or drop it. Alright, so with the diesel valve out of the way, you can see things a little bit more more clear. There's a gasket in between these two. And also during this time, you want to inspect these intake boots for any cracks. Since they're so close to the engine and the rubber, they do tend to dry right over time. And it's not uncommon that when you take these off, they'll crack, so kind of as a precautionary, you might want to order new ones before you do this repair. There we go. You can use a screwdriver, kind of wedge it down in between. This is the adapter I was talking about, wedging in behind here. You can kind of help pull it off. On M52TU motors, it's not uncommon to see this baffle. It's basically a silencer, so there's less intake noise. BMW ended up getting rid of this this baffle for later model BMW. So you can actually order like a 525i or a 325i intake boot, upper intake boot. It'll be the same thing just without this. So if you wonder what that is, now you know. All right, this is where you have to start feeling for all the individual screws. I can't actually see this one, but I was able to get the screwdriver in it. So I'm gonna loosen this upper clamp, which is for the idle control valve. And I have to feel around for the second hose clamp, which holds this boot onto the throttle body. And this is all by feel. All right, that's off. All right, so that's a lower intake boot. And now you'll inspect for cracks. As you can see, We got some cracking starting, so I'm going to replace this one. So take the hose clamps off and throw them off to the side for later. All right, you can see the throttle body and the idle control valve. The idle control valve sits in this bracket. You have to remove the bracket once again. I'm going to use T40s. And you also have to remove this 8mm nut. And if you haven't disconnected your battery, it's a good time to do so. Anytime you remove any kind of electrical component, just to be on the safe side, you can remove the ground terminal in the battery. You'll be fine. In my case, the battery's out of the car, so don't have to worry about that right now. Just gonna remove the idle control valve from the car entirely right now. It just kind of sits in the sleeve, so just slide it out. And also you can check the idle control valve, see if it's dirty or not. I did actually clean this a couple months back, so no reason to worry about this one for now. This is a cable driven throttle body, which was changed on some later models, so that like the M54 is all drive by wire. It's held in by 4 bolts. I believe these are 10 millimeters. I'll figure out here in a second. You have to remove the throttle body, and you also have to remove this main electrical connector harness from it. All right, so we're gonna start disconnecting a couple of other electrical connectors. This is a solenoid valve for the fuel tank system. This, I believe, is the intake air temperature sensor. So we'll disconnect that. We're gonna start disconnecting the electrical harness connector. It's a 10 millimeter. To allow me to move this electrical harness out of the way a little bit, I'm going to disconnect the dipstick tube bracket right here. It looks like a 12 millimeter bolt. I was mistaken, it's actually a 13. And this is actually the oil line or return line from the PCV valve. This is what drains back into the dipstick. We'll be replacing that shortly. Disconnect this. This is the oil temp. It's on the back of the oil filter housing. There's 4 bolts on the throttle body. They're all 10 millimeters, so we're gonna break those free. We're gonna disconnect this plug. This is the PCV valve right here. This is the drain tube going back to the dipstick. And then the other hoses for it connect over here. But you can see the general layout of this, why you have to remove all of this stuff from it. Just the only way to get to it. So we're going to go ahead and start removing the PCV system from the car and take you through those steps now. All right, there's basically 3 primary hoses that come up to the cylinder head. You have this one here, and then you have 2. One attaches to the intake spreader. The other one will attach to that hose coming to the spreader, which will then come over here. Basically, it distributes all the stuff coming up from the crank. So we're gonna go ahead and start taking these hoses off. To be honest with you, you're probably gonna break them when they come off, but that's fine because they're old and brittle. You can get a set of pliers to help you with this. Basically, compress actually just broke coming off anyway, so that's the concept. You compress these tabs and it'll come off, but so old and brittle, it just broke anyway, so. And to make the removal process easier, we'll just break the upper hose. I didn't even take that much effort to do it. The inside of that's actually not too bad. I don't see any what they call mayo yet, but you can see some gunk in there. This hose was actually already leaking onto the car. I could see some telltale signs right here on the electrical connector for the Vanos solenoid. You could see some oil, and you could see some oil down here. Only place it could have come from is this. This is the underside, and the underside is all sort of, I guess the best way to explain it, it kind of looks like Swiss cheese a little bit. So this was pretty much, this is pretty much done. So good thing we're doing this now. I want to release this a little bit so I can get a better angle on these hoses that connect to it. Intake temperature sensor, you'll want to disconnect that. So there's three T20 Torx bits that hold the spreader on the intake manifold. Better remove those. I didn't see this one, so I lied. It's four. So when you're moving the spreader, you'll probably hear a popping sound. That's just the gasket inside letting loose. Basically, I have to try to put even pressure on all of them. So this is the plenum spreader, and this one of the PCV valve hoses actually broke on that, so that just tells you how brittle this plastic actually was. There's a zip tie that's holding some of these vacuum lines on in the back. I'm gonna cut that here in a second. I mean, that's how brittle these hoses are. This is supposed to be a soft rubber. I mean, it's just, it's plastic. But once again, there isn't really too much gunk in there, which is a good sign. So I cut the zip tie off the spreader, and I was able to remove it. As you can see, once again, this is no longer rubber, it's just brittle. So I had to remove these two hoses from the intake spreader. I'm trying to be careful because, I mean, once again, the spreader is plastic, so I don't want to break this. They do sometimes recommend that you replace the spreader as stuff can build up inside of here, but this actually looks pretty clean, so I don't really feel the need to do that. What I will do, though, is replace these individual O-rings, as these O-rings can sometimes fail. These things are pretty hard right now and pretty brittle, so I have a feeling if I reinstall this, I might get a small vacuum leak, so I'll replace those individually here in a moment. You can see these individual O-rings here. I'm gonna go ahead and get like a toothpick, or not a toothpick, it's more or less a pick, and I'll just basically stretch it off and put the new ones on. Alright, so to put the new O-rings back on, all I'm going to do is I'm going to anchor it in the groove with my thumb, and with this flathead screwdriver, I'm going to round it over the top. I know you can't really see 100% what I'm doing here. I'm trying to stretch it. And then once you have it over the nipple, just roll it into place. Alright, there's one other vacuum line for the PCV. I'm actually replacing this whole line. It sits up here on top of the fuel rail. You can use the screwdriver to help slide it off. But original vacuum line, it's gonna be a little tough. There's two T20 two torque screws. There's one here next to the throttle body opening, and there's one up here. So I'll go ahead and start removing the PCV. Just be patient with this process. You have to feel for a lot of these little pieces, and next torque screw is a little bit higher on the valve. Alright, so this is the return line that goes down to the PCV. I'm going to release it from the dipstick tube. It's basically just sort of slides in place. I'm also going to replace the dipstick tube seal. I don't know if you could tell down there, but there's a little bit of an oil leak, so it's usually not a bad idea at this time to replace it. It's just a little O-ring. So you're going to remove the dipstick, and then the dipstick basically slides off. There's an electrical connector here that you got to remove. And it just comes right out. And we'll clean up any oil spill that might have happened while I pulled it out. So I'm putting the O-ring back inside the tube here. There's like a seat at the bottom. That's where it's supposed to be. And it'll kind of just seat itself. Like that. And then you can push the dipstick tube back in. I'm just going to clean up the extra oil spill around here. So now we're going to remove the PCV valve from the car. Got a vacuum line here, which remember we disconnected that earlier. I'm going to pull this through. You're going to have to probably wrestle with it a little bit, but the remnants of the hoses are still kind of in the way. All right, that's the old PCV valve out. Actually just broke it out. That's how brittle it was. So trying to see any signs of, there's no what they call mayo, so there doesn't seem to be any condensation issues with this. Just old and brittle. There's a little bit of gunk up here. You see it's been allowed to build up in these channels. It's basically hard dried stuff. So this usually happens, it just gets clogged up, and that's why I had to replace these things. So let's get to that. All right, so with all the old stuff out, here's some of the new stuff. Here's about 5 meters of vacuum line. This is for basically this run from the fuel rail down to the breather. Obviously don't need all of it, but there's other parts of the car where I'm probably gonna need this in the future, so might as well have it in bulk. Here is one of the breather hoses, the one that sits up here underneath the intake spreader. This one's from Miley. Here's another Miley hose. This is the main hose that comes up to the valve cover, kind of sits in there like that. This is the drain hose, so this is what goes back down to the dipstick. This is made by CRP. And here's one other breather hose. This one comes up to the intake spreader, so kind of comes up under the intake manifold. There's actually a slot made directly for it. And actually, this second breather hose right here will attach like that. But I'll kind of go through how the whole thing is laid out. Here's a new intake gasket for the throttle body. You're going to need to replace this. And here's the BMW. It's a genuine BMW, so it comes from straight from the dealership. This is the brand new breather valve. And here's the new lower intake rubber boot. Once again, genuine BMW. And the little swivel plate slash gasket for it. So these are the parts that we're going to be installing now. And let's get to the reinstallation process of the new PCV system. All right, so the first thing I'm going to do is I'm going to reassemble the pipes coming up to the intake plenum spreader. So the orientation of the spreader is like this. This hose will attach here. You're going to have to wait for that click. That means it's secured. And then you have this hose here. It kind of just slides into place. You're not going to really hear a click, but you'll know it's secured because it seats fully. And then this end here is going to connect to this second connector, and you're going to want to push that in until it seats all the way. That's the hose setup for the spreader. What I'm going to do now is I'm actually going to take this hose, which is flexible, so you can see it just kind of slides down there, and you're not going to be able to see it, but I'm going to grab the hose, which is there. I'm going to spin it around so it's facing where the valve will be. You can just see it with my fingers there. So that's kind of the orientation that you're going to want. Remember to reconnect the air intake temperature sensor. You can do it at this time. When you hear the click, you know it's all the way there. Now this is the second breather hose. Once again, it has a swivel on it. So basically, this hose, if this portion is connected to this, this will clip into this place. Actually, it goes like this. It'll clip into that, and this comes all the way up to the valve cover here. So I'm going to run this down into position. Alright, so now comes time to position the breather valve. What I'll do here as well is I'll attach the return line while we're at it, which comes right here to the bottom. And the return line kind of runs in behind the electrical connector. The important part of this is kind of remembering the routing of everything, which can be kind of confusing. So that's kind of the orientation that you want when you're sliding the valve back into place. And what you kind of have to do with it is you have to push it down and then let it come up. It has to clear this portion of the intake manifold. It's basically you have the throttle body here, and these two big tubes that come right up here to the top main, or the main part of the plenum, and that's what you have to try to clear when you're putting this valve back in place. All right, with these hoses, you really have to take your time and work them into position. This one in particular is a little tricky only because it has to route underneath the intake manifold. That is a twist, basically the connector twist, and that's how it locks onto the valve. This one that comes down from the valve cover, that has to be pushed into place, and you have to listen for the click. Once you hear the click, you know it's properly seated and you won't have a vacuum leak. The last thing you want to do on this is get everything done, the car back together, start the car, and hear a whistling noise knowing that you have a vacuum leak somewhere. So take your time, make sure everything's seated properly, and you won't have a problem. So I'll go ahead and secure this now. So I'm going to re-secure the valve. Kind of crooked right now, but I'm gonna try to guide it back into place.
good.
Alright, so that's all set. Now, just as hard as it was to take this out, expect it to be just as hard as putting it back in. Alright, now the million-dollar question is, how do you know it's properly seated? Well, every mounting point should be level with where it mounts to the intake manifold. If it's not level, then you know you haven't pushed them in all the way. But these look like they're there, so we can go ahead and re-secure the brackets or the bracket mounting hardware back on. I'm just going to slide the drain tube onto the dipstick. And you're gonna push it down until it's seated all the way. All right, so before reinstalling everything back on the car, the last thing you have to do in regards to the PCV system is install this vacuum line. You could reuse this old vacuum line, but as you can tell, it's kind of dry rotted and it'll probably fail, so. This stuff is usually pretty cheap anyway, so I might as well just go ahead and replace it anyway. And it attaches onto a nipple on the side of the PCV, which is towards the bottom of the valve. You can see it right there. Just gonna run this on. That's good. Next step, I'm gonna run it up through the intake manifold. Basically the route that it has to take, and I'm gonna cut it right about here. I'd rather have a little bit extra than cut it too short. I'm gonna slide it right back on. All right, depending upon the length of the wire, you can pretty much determine where things go plus the prongs. So for example, we know this one right here was on this right here. Just orient it correctly. This connection goes into this sensor in the back. There's only one way to put them on, so you don't have to worry about reversing polarity or anything like that. Also make sure that they don't get tangled up. I'm replugging the intake camshaft position sensor. It connects to this electrical connector right here. Once again, you can only insert it one way. And it's the only plug in this series of cables that is a male connector. All right, now here's the throttle body. It's a very good practice to replace this gasket if you remove it from the intake manifold. That's exactly what we're gonna do. We're just gonna gently lift it out. And the new one, you're just gonna push into place. The throttle body's position goes a little something like this. And the idle control valve goes overhead. I'm gonna put the throttle body back in place. Remember we had 10 millimeter bolts for that. And the electrical connector is a basically screw-in type. You do have some arrows that you're supposed to line up. So should be, it's only gonna seat one way. And then once it finally seats, you're going to twist this knob and lock it into place. And the arrows should line up. To go a little bit further, make a good connection. There we go. You'll hear a little click, and that's how you know you've fully secured the electrical connector for the throttle body.
We're going to slide the throttle body back into position. Now, this is a cable-driven throttle body, which is a little unusual. So you're going to want to make sure that basically this guide here, or that this wire matches up. It's very important, otherwise you might have some strange throttle response, maybe a couple varicodes. So be aware of what you're doing when you're sliding this back into place. And you're gonna have to do this by feel, because you surely can't see anything. All right, we're just about lined up. So I'm gonna take the first bolt and I'm gonna thread it. I'm not gonna go all the way yet. I just wanna basically get it secured first. I'm just gonna get these hand tight for now. And you have to pretty much feel for these bottom ones because you can't really see them, but fortunately, once you get them to their home, you'll feel it start to thread. And you don't have to go crazy tight. The gasket will help seal it. You just want to make sure that these are hand tight. Alright, so next thing is the idle control valve. You're going to slide it into this sleeve and it holds it in place. Now, if you're concerned about orientation, just look for the arrow. The arrow right there is telling you that it needs to go in like that. There's a little rubber grommet that's going to slide into. Make sure it's facing upward. But you want to try to reassemble everything as it came off. I'm going to reconnect the idle control valve. And now you're going to push this idle control valve into the grommet. It's going to be kind of tough. Just making sure that it's in all the way. And it seems to be that it's seated. Now you need to start reassembling this bracket. Once again, you know, for you guys that have a drive-by-wire system, you don't need to worry about this. But for those of you that have an actual throttle cable, you need to make sure that the throttle cable is around that little groove. If it's off, you'll need to readjust that. So just be aware of that. Remember, there's a little 10 millimeter nut that secures part of the electrical connector here. It sits right below the throttle body, so you'll want to re-secure that. Which that will re-secure the bracket to the car. These connections don't have to be crazy tight. Make sure that they're hand tight. Remember replacing that lower intake boot? So I'm gonna slide the new one on with the old hose clamps. And you wanna try to orient these in a friendly position. Basically, so that you can remove them again if you needed to. It's also worth noting that you can usually tell when the when it's seated properly, because if you look down, there's a little lip inside of the intake boot, and that'll usually indicate whether it's seated properly or not. Slide them into place. Diesel valve back on next. And you basically want to push it in, so you'll kind of like feel it click in place a little bit. That's how you know it's fully seated. Once again, these are T40s. We're going to reconnect the electrical connector for it. Pretty much leaves us one electrical connection, and that's for the mass airflow sensor. Also, don't forget to re-secure your dipstick tube to the motor support. That was a 13 millimeter. I'll go ahead and thread that back in now. And just wiggle it around, it's secure. Here's the new connector. Normally don't have to replace these, but I figured it couldn't hurt. It's kind of inside here. Almost caught it. We had two hose clamps, one on the lower intake boot. And just remember, try to orient it in the easiest way to access. So for me, I like to kind of point them this way, because you can typically get a really good long screwdriver on it. I'm putting in the new seal ring onto the lower intake boot. These typically aren't a problem, but in part of the process, you might as well just replace these old parts so they don't give you an issue in the future. And I'm going to take a hose clamp and tighten that up now. And once again, you don't have to go crazy tight, just until it's snug. And I'll just kind of slide over like that. Feel around the edges, make sure that it's seated all the way. This one has. And we'll tighten down the hose clamp. And that's secure. Remember, you need to replace the vacuum line. It goes in way easier than it comes out. So if you feel like it went in too easy, that's okay. Now we're gonna put the mass airflow sensor back in. And if you want to, it's a good time to clean it down with a mass airflow sensor cleaner. Make sure it's MassSense cleaner only. Don't touch the wires. Ten sprays is usually all you need. It also dries up fast, and it can also prolong the life of your mass airflow sensor. So, not a bad thing to do. I'm not going to tighten down the hose clamp yet. Now, as mentioned earlier, this is an aftermarket intake, clearly, so the install procedure is a little different than it would be for an airbox. But the overall installation process and the steps you need to take are the same, so don't worry about that. You want to orient the clips and snap them into place. And then your last electrical connector, which is your mass airflow sensor. And now you can tighten down this hose clamp once you readjust it accordingly. Once again, I like to angle everything towards me, so if I have to remove it. And the last thing you need to do, and this is when you know the job is pretty much coming to a completion, put your filter housing boxes back on. Sometimes you have to wrestle these a little bit, but you want to seat this side first. It'll also fall into place. want to make sure that this seat's up against the weather stripping. That's going to clip into place like that. I'm going to re-secure the filter box. There's little hooks that come under. That's 10 millimeter screws to hold that down. And last but not least, you're going to reconnect this connector to the hood release. Make sure the car is unlocked, otherwise the car alarm will go off because they'll think the car is being stolen. So that's good. And so that's how you install the PCV system on an M52TU motor or M54 motor. I hope this helps you. Just remember, take your time when you're doing this. Make sure you do things thoroughly. This will give you tens of thousands of trouble-free miles ahead of you. If you do have any questions, give us a call at 877-634-0063. We'll be happy to answer any questions you have. And thank you for watching.